Age of Empires 2 is an incredibly complex game. The four basic resources, food, wood, stone, and gold, count up as hundreds of units hit the field, and each with unique costs, production time, and technologies. And they're facing an equal force, with varying melee armor, pierce armor, movement speed, and attack stats on a randomly generated map. When these armies engage, these numbers collapse into an elegant, beautiful chaos. This chaos, this collage of data, harbors the complexity that allows everyone to play the game in a uniquely personalized way. For mere mortals, flawlessness is unattainable, but chasing perfection is where the good are separated from the great. The human element separates each player's unique tendencies and playstyle. T90 Officials Hidden Cup tournaments are a celebration of this. In a tournament like no other, players are given hidden identities and can only speak through their gameplay while competing for the most prolific title in Age of Empires 2. At the start of 2021, T90 hosted his fourth and largest of these events, and today we explore why Hidden Cup 4 was historic. The Hidden Cup 4 main event is comprised of 16 players, each secretly given an alias of a historical unit from the game. Under these pseudonyms, these top players battle it out on 12 exciting maps. For the players, it requires them to play to their own strengths, as they cannot prepare for their enemy's weaknesses. For the audience, the event becomes a chaotic game of guess who, as fans look to identify their favorites and predict who will take home the over $87,000 prize pool. Before the main event, one of the largest qualifiers kicked off, with 64 players competing for 8 slots to join the invited 8 on the final weekend. In 64 sets of games, these players duked it out for who would have a chance at the title. These qualifiers were too numerous to watch, but that doesn't mean they weren't worth watching. Over 2 weeks, among many clean sweeps, some miraculous storylines began to emerge.
Two Maganels, you've got to be kidding me. What in God's name is this confidence overtaken? Hello? What? 55 seed, baby. Okay, finally takes a hit. The repair villagers aren't here. There's also another Maganel on the way.
Overtaken, the 55th seed, found reward with risky, aggressive playstyle and highlight reel micromanagement as he swept Madri in the first round. Classic Pro stunned Zuppi 3-0 and nearly beat Velez in an extremely close set. Lix shocked Miguel with YOLO plays in the round of 32.
Oh no! Oh god, Lix was so close there. Can Lix get it again? Okay, never a doubt. Again, Lix is so good with that.
And not long after quitting his job in marketing to be a full-time player and content creator, Jordan looked like a beast versus Kapash, winning 3-2 in an unfortunately early matchup.
Kapash really has to change his game plan now. He has to quick wall like crazy, but if he walls in his villagers here, he doesn't have loom. He doesn't have loom! The villagers are not loomed! The villagers will go down so quickly here. He has to remember to get loom. The pressure is on.
Rubenstock played games of what loosely may be considered Age of Empires, but Hart earned his right to disagree with that sentiment as he moved on to the decider qualifier, best of 7 set. In these deciders, ACCM eked past Daniel in 7, and as did Valise over land.
Daniel says good luck in the tourney. He realizes it's a big moment for ACCM.
Jordan continued his run with a huge victory against the Hidden Cup 2 finalist, the Max.
Here comes the elephant, boys! He's chopping our trees! Ah! The ballista elephant's here! Key for Jordan was controlling the game, and Jordan returns to Hidden Cup. What a series from Jordan, and what great defense in this game! He knew it was coming!
Winchester slammed his Canadian foe, breezing his way to the main event, and Barros, who was the last to surprise in the qualifiers, beat Hart, the favorite, making his way to his first S-tier main event in his career.
Probably the end for Hart, something I never would have expected after seeing that Hart was up 3-1.
After 2 weeks and hundreds of games, these 16 players that will represent Hidden Cup 4 were given new identities, and the speculation began. As the event drew closer, there was a palpable silence that rose over the community. Pros were spending their time solely on preparation, and the rest waited eagerly in anticipation. The 16 elite talents that represented Hidden Cup 4 each had their own tendencies, preferences, and playstyle. In the past, Hidden Cups became a game of Find the Viper, as he won the first three iterations of the event with utter domination. But this time around, there was no clear favorite, but fans were still on the lookout for clean and exciting gameplay to snuff out the Snake pseudonym. The Austrian player Leary was also a strong contender, and the new kid on the block after a remarkable 2020. Leary was known for inhuman micro. Brutal pressure and extremely clean control were his namesake. Mr. Yo was known for bold strategies and unmistakable awareness in the most chaotic late games. Hera was another favorite to win the cup. While he had yet to take home a first place prize in a 1v1 event, he was consistently making his way to the finals with cold and calculated defensive playstyle that blossomed into relentless pressure in the late game. These four were the favorites, but by no means were guaranteed a podium finish. The rest of the lot included the master strategist Tato, the veteran Doubt, a returning legend in Jordan, and an entire group of elite talent that were ready to make Hidden Cup history. On March 18th, 2021, the historic Hidden Cup 4 began.
We're gonna hop in here, game number one, between Warwolf and Jacqueline. There's a lot of questions. You don't know who these players are, but we'll find out in 4 days. And for viewers out there, I just want to say a big thank you to everyone who's been a part of this, and I hope you enjoy.
After dropping Arabia in game one, Warwolf won 3 straight to move on. Unbeknownst to the live spectators, who wouldn't learn the true identities until after the finals, they had seen the Polish pro Barls as the first contestant to go home.
The castles stay up, and if there's castles in the middle, there's more stone to mine, there's more gold to mine. And I think this is done and dusted. Jacqueline is out. Jacqueline loses to Warwolf. What a response from this Warwolf player.
Next up was the Admiral, and his opponent started out laming a boar and had a playstyle that was unmistakably the work of the Master Boar Lamer, MBL.
No hesitation. Game one, big tournament. No hesitation. There's a few players that come to mind, picking Mongols on Arabia and going crazy with the lames. Chat's saying MBL already. I don't know, there might be some other players, we'll see.
Many were shocked to see what they could only assume was the Norwegian lose to an impressive but not clearly identifiable opponent.
This is perfect play from Admiral. The game sense to understand, forget about archers if you're gonna play like this. Let's go Halb and Ram. Even though it doesn't necessarily suit my Civ, it suits the situation. This is quality, and I feel even if Master of Templar takes out the Rams, the Trebs are behind this, really. So,
well, no castles left anyways.
Yeah.
4 Trebs there doing such a good job. Havadi is pushing forward. Longbowman at it as well.
Wow. And yeah, now you could start to mix in some Longbowman if champions were to come out. And Master of the Templar gets 3-1 by Admiral Yi Sun Shin. What a performance, Nili. One of the more unique Gold Rush games we've honestly seen in the event so far, of course, but the qualifier too.
I'm just impressed. That was really solid play.
The crowd sussed out Winchester as Harald Hadrade in the third set from his Civ and map picks alone, and he was stunned by some impressive plays from the unknown Sujata.
Is it Tato,
upgrade,
or is it someone who realizes they've won this game and they want to fake people out and think, have us think that it could be Tato? I could see Sinjata being Tato, realistically.
Yeah.
But actually,
yeah.
No, I couldn't, because he sucked on islands, man. This isn't Tato.
Celts, you're right. He wouldn't go Celts.
This is a faker.
This is Yo. I'm pretty confident in a Yo prediction on Sinjata.
Okay.
I told myself in this event I'm going to predict fairly confidently, because if I'm going to be wrong, I may as well be wrong with conviction. But Harald calls the GG. He taps out as he's receiving pressure on every side.
Well, okay, what's weird about that is, was that strategy practiced? Like, another thing that makes me think Winchester.
Gonzalo Pizarro had an epic set, reverse sweeping Pope Ligo in spectacular fashion. Fans were torn on who went drop the series, but in retrospect, it turned out Valise had been kicked out in devastating fashion.
And Pope Leo.
There it is.
Respect, by the way, to whoever Pope Leo is, says GG, good luck next, and Gonzalo completes the reverse sweep. What did we
the
just
reverse
witness?
Sweep?
Vivailo obliterated his opposition 3-0 in a series so short that no one could have known that it sent DeGao home to an impressive opponent.
And the GG's just called. The GG's just called. The score was 2-0 already, and the King says, I'm not going to fight on anymore. I can't beat this player. What in the world was that game, Neely?
Oh yeah, and I think we will see more from Evalio for sure in this tournament, and King Bela likely to be looking back Sunday evening when we reveal the identities and will be like, damn, I got unlucky.
Edward Longshanks beat the fan favorite hero Cobra Carr in a messy, exciting, and fun set. To the surprise of few, it was Vivi behind the wheel of the Cobra Carr, and the affectionately named Fat Dragon was done. John the Fearless vs. Leloy was a best of five set that will not soon be forgotten. Due to random seeding, top players can beat in the first round, and it was clear that two titans were duking it out. In an absolutely thrilling set, full of demos, deeks, dodges, and elite gameplay, it was clear that Tato's signature play was behind Leloy, who fell to a near flawless defensive play from John the Fearless.
A huge demo shot slam, and that's only gonna continue.
Yeah.
Middle area, heavy demos coming in! And getting hits, worthy of a highlight as well, honestly.
He's really got to make a move on this end. I mean, there's still a lot of gold left for John in the middle.
But it's still Seedram, and we've been saying for years, Slam, Britain's die to Seedram, massive demo.
Wow, another good demo hit.
But now the castle's going down for Leloy in the middle. And so he could start losing economy too. Oh God. Oh God. Oh man, this is gonna be crazy. John the Fearless sees it all. The demos go in and the biggest explosions you'll probably see in Hidden Cup 4 come in. Huge. But is it enough? I feel like a lot of demos went down there.
And he's just going to be down to halves. Oh, big demo hit on the champs.
I think we could possibly be seeing someone like Leary or the Viper or Mr. Yo or Tato. Those names come to mind for Leloy. It is more than realistic based on how the series has gone. And respect to Leloy for saying that, and respect this series. John the Fearless moves on to the quarterfinals tomorrow, and what a way to do it, Slam.
Incredible series between these two.
That was just sick. And the best game of the series was the final game of the series.
In the final set of the opening round, Philip the Good looked elite, stomping his foe, who was eventually revealed to be Mikov at the end of the weekend.
He's got crown. Okay, there it is.
Yeah, there's the GG. Well, Philip the Good played pretty darn good in this series, and we'll move on, knocking out my favorite hero, Feels Bad, in the first round. Well, I'm not too upset about that, Slam. I want the best players to advance, and whoever these players were, Philip the Good was certainly the better of the two.
And the first round had ended. After 2 days of riveting competition, 8 players moved on, and the armchair experts at home began their homebrew calculations to determine who was still left alive. The excitement was palpable. And after a short night, the quarterfinals kicked off on day 3.
A few players that move on to the quarters where I feel like I've got them pegged, but there's others, and I'm really unsure. I'm going to have to rewatch some of those tonight before tomorrow quarterfinals begin.
We should have a good day today. Should have a good series to start it off. And of course, starting it off with game number 1, Arabia. And I see some villagers now coming from blue. Is this going to be a forward? This is a man-at-arms forward play.
Okay, now this starts to make you think, who could this be? Because there's a lot of players who wouldn't forward. 3 years ago, forward was kind of meta in some ways, but not today. So we have a player going forward, and immediately people were like, is this Vivi? Is this Yo?
Yeah, and he's gonna abandon building the tower? Okay, so it was a bait.
Yep, it was a bait. That's a smart thing to do, right? He didn't even see the enemy was building a counter tower, but maybe just felt that might be the case. And now that he sees the tower's already gone up, he says, haha, that's funny, I'm gonna take your wood line. Because he was actually trying to chop that tree and palisade over it to get through, but oh man, disaster for Warwolf.
That's not gonna go up. GG's called, Tristan. All caps.
All
GG.
Caps. This is probably the final effort here, Dave. And when the fire ships go down and the castle goes up, then for Admiral, I think we'll see the GG called. What a great defensive game from Admiral yet again in this series. Remember, we have a lot of Viper votes there. So, Viper, Doubt second place with 25%, and then Jordan. So, players all on the same team. 41% think it's the Viper. Okay.
The Admiral, after a coincidentally strong performance on water maps, moved on with a 3-1 victory. While it was, of course, not revealed at the time, many rightfully predicted that it was the Vietnamese pro ACCM that had fallen. The Admiral, on the other hand, was still a mystery. He had looked absolutely dominant, and his performance on hybrid maps seemed eerily like the Viper, but there was still no tell. Plus, many had pegged Evalio as the Viper, and it felt somehow as if both were the Norwegian pro. Alas, the mystery continued in the next set with Sanjata versus Gonzalo Pizarro.
We have Huns game one for Gonzalo Pizarro and Sanjata playing as the Aztecs. I'm a little bit surprised to see Huns here, Dave. What about you?
I think if we're looking at a player, if we were discussing Yo, right? If we're looking at a player like Yo, he's going to keep this forward pressure.
Yep.
Whoever Sanjata is, or he's going to keep this forward pressure and then add a few TCs behind. And there's the second TC for his economy.
He might realize that something might be looping around
on him. Looping around behind. He's not going to the economy. He's going to go behind the army.
He was in there with three as well to snipe the monk, Dave. That was really good for Gonzalo. Wow, now I think he should get out of here with these three cav archers, and he's not really microing these other ones the best. So about 3 minutes until Sanjata has an unkillable force, I'd say Dave Gonzalo needs to get more and more kills.
He has to be looking at the score. He has to be looking at the number, sheer number of eagles being produced right now and thinking, there's really no chance for me in this game.
There's your castle drop, Dave. It's going to come on the left side. That's a get out of my game castle. Man, did Sanjata look good, Dave. Wouldn't say Gonzalo's best trait is his micro. Let's just put it that way. And noticing Pizarro, there's a trend here. He seems like a classic player who probably loves his eco. So getting an early lead in Castlake, like he wasn't able to do in the previous game, is huge. And he's still got camels on the stone, Dave. Fantastic
that
action
camel's
here.
Saving itself. It's saving itself for a big woodline boom.
There you go. And Dave, I continue to be surprised by the population. It's honestly just the fact that Gonzalo has so many bills. It doesn't feel like Gonzalo has 20 more pop on the map.
This is a crazy
look
game.
Look at the hussars from Gonzalo. He's not dead, Dave. He's going to continue to fight. He's finding the farms now. What a game. Gonzalo was in such a good position here. And you see GGT, GG. That's not going to add some drama to this at all. And the GG from Sanjata, and the score is 2-0. And Dave, one of the best games we've seen. Who in the world are these players?
That was an insane performance from both. I mean, usually find yourself cheering for the players that maybe, you know, don't have the same speed, make up for it in different areas, right? Yeah. I really feel like Gonzalo is one of those, but you have to appreciate the skill level of Sanjata. Like, it's just been insane. The recognition to go for an extra two stables here and the Castle Age pressure has just caught Pizarro off guard, and he calls the GG, and what an amazing set we just witnessed.
Sanjata's beautiful performance led to a 3-1 victory over who was later revealed to be the Serbian player, Doubt. The unique tactics used by Sanjata, combined with extremely impressive late game control, had the feel of a certain Chinese player, but the mystery continued further, and the action continued in the next set.
I guess he'll realize when he needs the pike, when he has clicked up to imp, and the GG has just called, Dave. Edward Longshanks realizes that the 2TC approaches did not pay off. He probably sees his pop as 130, and he thinks this is fine, but it's just the Vittoria population, because he's got three of them, and yet he calls the GG, and the game ends. Vilo goes up 2-0, looking very, very strong, Dave. Architecture, hoardings, these are techs that are not needed right now. This is boost the score to get the enemy to resign type of a deal. And that castle is eventually going to go down, and Edward does tap out, Dave. Calls the GG. I think I know who Evilo is. It just felt like the Viper and a few of those small things. I mean, the victories, right? The dominance, the lack of worry in many of these games, the greed in many of these games. But more than anything, I think
if it is, though, Tristan, and we don't, guys, remember, we don't know, so... We're just throwing guesses out there. If it is Viper, how nice is that? The snake is back, man. He's dominating. Two series in a row, just crushing his opponents. Mm-hmm.
There you go. Vote for the winner, guys. The only undefeated player. Who do you think it is? Take a stab at it. I am going to say we found the snake with the Viper, meaning the winner would face a Vilo tomorrow. We think Hera's in there, and some people are saying Leary's in there too. So there's some big names on this side of the bracket.
Evalio looked strong after two pristine clean sweeps, including dominating performances on hybrid maps. Edward Longshanks, who was the pseudonym of Back, fell to an opponent that had a certain je ne sais quoi that only a few players could replicate. To many fans, two clean sweeps in itself was enough to confirm Evalio as the Viper. But the more skeptical members held their cards close, as the day was not done, and two very strong players were meeting the final set of the round of eight.
We have Philip the Good in round two, and we have John the Fearless sticking with blue and going Vikings for game number one. But here comes a Spearman and an Archer right now. And quick gate there from John the Fearless. Sick stuff. Just keeps that scout away. And Philip the Good looking to damage, and it just feels like we have a very aggressive player on our hands in Philip the Good. And then we have a very defensive player on our hands in John the Fearless, who's good with macro. And it's going to make for a great series here.
This is a ball of death coming down the middle. And Yellow's really going to struggle to find
gold.
Any answers to this.
Yeah. No gold, Dave.
You're going to get shredded, bud.
Especially when that eco is so strong. John the Fearless expanding on the sides to see everything. Ram still taking out buildings.
I can't help but feel like Philip's just sitting there like, wow, well, that escalated quickly.
Yeah. certainly, as John the Fearless gets his win, impressive from both, but John the Fearless the better of the two. Philip is in a position to possibly micro down the crossbows and avoid the Mangonel. Let's see.
Well, all here's right. The Mangonels from Philip, and they're coming forward, and they wipe up the two Mangonels from John the Fearless at the front as he's microing at the back, too.
And he was doing, like, how did he dodge a Mangonel, take out two crossbows, losing one, and also take out those Mangonels at the same time? Ridiculous.
Yeah, that was a crazy display from Philip. And, you know, it all stems back to the fact that John's doc, maybe a little bit late, falling a little bit farther behind a feudal age. Philip wins the water and then takes that food control and spirals it to victory.
A longsword against Lord Raiders. The Lord Raiders are not elite, but the longsword could all get destroyed. Oh,
that
my.
Was a great, great shot from Philip the Good. And now it feels like he might have a chance here, Tristan.
And the GG's called 2 minutes later.
Crazy. That's a masterclass right there.
Seriously.
From John the Fearless. Because Philip put on some good pressure, but John just survived. He walled in the correct spots. He castled over on that left side, which was kind of unexpected for us, but that gave him the water control he needed. Well played from John the Fearless, and Philip's got to figure out something to do against this defensive play.
Confidence from John the Fearless. I think John the Fearless is about to head to the semifinals tomorrow. What a hit with the bombard cannons.
Yep.
Everything has been so near perfect with macro in this tournament for John the Fearless. And you have Philip the Good say, GG, good luck next. And John the Fearless says, GG, thank you. John the Fearless moves on. What a day of Age of Empires, Dave.
That was an insane set. You could feel the quality of both of those players coming through the screen. I wonder what they're going to vote for. Wow, what suspense.
There is a chance that we maybe flipped who we think is who, though. Would you agree with that statement? Like, maybe some chance?
No.
I tried. I tried.
With four players left, the crowd had some heavy suspicion, to say the least. The Admiral was the least clear of the crew, but through the process of elimination, many assumed the seafaring hero was the German legend Jordan, which was shocking to see. Half a decade ago, Jordan beat the Viper in a historic best of 21, properly dubbed the Duel of the Century, and Jordan, for a time, claimed the title as the best Age of Empires player. But years later, Jordan was merely starting his comeback after a year hiatus from the game. He had not yet been seen in top form, but he was improving fast, and it was no secret that Jordan was one of, if not the most prepared player in the event. It seemed surreal, but it only made sense that the Admiral was the smiling pro. But many could not believe how strong this player looked, and doubted Jordan could look so strong so fast. Senjata surely had to be the moniker of the Chinese player Mr. Yo, whose elite and unique playstyle shined through in his gameplay. The same could be said for Revilo, whose dominating performance was surely the work of the three-time Hidden Cup champion and heavy favorite to win again, the Viper. John the Fearless had also been easily sleuthed out at this point in more than a few ways, and had walked an absolutely grueling path to the semifinals, beating Tato 3-2 in the opening round, and then the Austrian pro Leary in the next. Nobody was given stiffer cards than what could be assumed to be the Canadian Hera, whose daunting path continued versus the king of Hidden Cups and goat of the game, the Viper. But if anyone had been on a trajectory to dethrone the snake, it was Hera. About a month before the event, Hera went on an impressive grind, becoming the first player to reach 2600 matchmaking rating after what can only be described as a dominating performance on the ladder. Hera would certainly need this momentum to carry over from preparation to practicality as he faced the favorite, the Viper. The same could be said for the Admiral, who is likely the returning legend Jordan versus the impeccable Mr. Yo. And then, on the final day of the historic Hidden Cup 4, the semifinals kicked off.
Ladies and gents, thank you for being here. 15,000 people for game number one, and here we go. I'll be honest with you guys, you know, I am so blown away already with the amount of support as Admiral in the red as playing as Vikings, and then Senjata, surprise, surprise, Dave, going for the Mayans.
The plumes are behind, still doing damage to the reinforcements.
Mayans are just insane, Dave. It is 3-2 with the relics. The relics are actually rather far forward for Senjata. And again, stone's an issue, but it's more of an issue for Senjata now, as he is actually off of stone because of that castle, and it has to buy stone soon, maybe, to keep the castle up.
Senjata's stone walling on the right side of his base. We're in for a long one here, I think.
You are kidding me, Senjata. The castle is down, Dave. The Onager, as I said, should go down if he notices it's weak. He might forget, and the Onager's getting huge value. But there it goes, and now Admiral has to back away, and now Senjata is ramming the left side. It's going to get to the point where both players are going to be completely out of gold, and both civs actually suck without gold.
These Mayan skirmishers are ridiculous. Actually ridiculous. He's pushing them back again.
This is so weird. I don't think I've ever seen so many skirmishers in 1v1 before. It makes sense. Don't get me wrong, but it also is very, very unique. But just lines and lines and lines and lines of skirms. This is so stupid, man.
It really is. It really is.
You know me. As a Force Nothing fanatic, I love stupid things, all right? So maybe our opinions differ a little bit on this, Dave. But the uniqueness of this game, I'm going to remember for a long time.
This game is swinging in Senjata's favor. I mean, once that woodline is gone for Admiral, where does he shift to? He's got the one on the left, I guess, but Blue's army is so close.
Yeah. But Dave, it's more military for Admiral. Look at all the villagers here for Sinjata. If he loses 20-some villagers and loses access to wood for even a few moments, what could happen here?
Well, he's got 1,600 in the bank.
True.
So if he loses villagers, you know what that means.
More skirmishers.
Dude, the Mayan privilege has brought him back into this game.
And there's freaking skirms?
It's over. What happened here? What happened to production? It's like Sinjata just took his foot off the pedal.
He calls the GG and he gives the well played. That is just game number one of the semifinals, Dave. What a crazy way to start it off. And Sinjata, even before that, realizes the situation. Realizes that that's probably coming. The score is 2-0 here, folks. The Admiral is... he's not destroying Sinjata because game one was so close. But certainly in this game, he heavily outplayed him. There's the GG. And the GG is called, Dave. And Sinjata says good luck next round. Absolute respect to Sinjata. We will salute Sinjata in the chat right now because that was a sick performance. But the Admiral too good, Dave. And I am just so excited to see Admiral in the final later. Jordan, if you're listening, I'm really sorry. And this is probably pretty poor from a business perspective to say that it would be a shock if Jordan were to 4-1 Mr. Yo there. But I still, not that I don't have faith in Jordan that he can't bump it up to that next level. It still would be a big surprise to me if that was Jordan. And Jordan is indeed the favorite amongst the community, not a landslide by any means. And we have Evilo, who, was that a misplaced barracks at the start?
It was a barracks. I was paused at the start of this game and he accidentally built a barracks there. Both players are just kind of hanging out in this area and there's the castle.
Oh, that shot, dude, that was an attack round and this castle might never go up, Dave. That was such a sick attack round. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but the level here is unreal, and here we go, the knights are diving.
Villagers going down to the mangonels and the shots are coming in.
Absolute domination. The crossbows are gone, the castle's denied, villagers are idle within every TC. Evilo just owned him, dude, and after watching John the Fearless own everybody else with this play, I cannot help but just be in shock. The way John the Fearless played this was so good. It was so unbelievably good. And we saw him get to this point with that style of play. And Evilo said, I don't even care. Like, that is just... Mayans is the better civilization. That style, it suits John the Fearless. It suits Mayans. And that was just unreal, Dave. But like, okay, economically, the fishing runs out. But what is John doing to threaten Evilo? That's the big problem. Nothing.
The problem with skirmishers is that they're gonna really struggle to do decent damage against that mangonel.
It's also like, it's the worst. You would never, if you're watching this at home, never play like this, I feel like. I mean, maybe it's a matter of preference, Dave, but most humans are just gonna get completely destroyed by this type of style, like giving up control consistently.
And now he's gonna start building up army again.
Look at that micro there. Split micro with skirmishers against the mangonel up the hill, no problem. Stop the decay of Zico. He denies the castle! Wait, does he? He does deny the castle in the north. John the Fearless could do this in the fight in the front, Dave!
Fight in the front, hops in the castle.
Monk's
maybe
there.
Spits out the other side. The monk is just now getting back with that relic, but this push, it seems unstoppable.
It surely is unstoppable. But is this not a sign of how good Byzantines are against Huns? It's been so tough for Evilo. If I would have written up a script for a perfect game here, it wouldn't have included half the things that we've seen. And there we see the GG. Evilo's still undefeated in Hidden Cup 4 in the second semifinal. One of the most impressive technical, strategic, whatever you want to say, displays in Age of Empires right there.
55,000 to you, but here we go. Game number 3, and we are into Bay. We've got Italians for John the Fearless, and we've got Mongols for Evilo.
Oh no.
Here come the onagers, they're so fast.
Oh no. Oh no. All right, well, good splits from John as he confidently goes in here, and why are you doing that? And now the light cav come in, big attack rounds possible. We'll probably see a split from the cav though, expecting it. And we see both, actually. Oh, no, but the arbs go down, and now two bomber cannons go down. And here come the Cavalier, and the Cavalier split and should be enough to take out as Valio kills his own villagers. What in the world, Dave? But the castle's down.
That trap killed the castle foundation too, and it might kill this one as well. He killed two castle foundations with that one treb, but it doesn't matter. John the Fearless in such a dominating position right now, and he takes back a game from a Vilo who looked so good in the first two.
We have John the Fearless looking to tie things up in this epic semifinal. In the red, we have Turks for Evilo. Looking very, very good for John the Fearless currently. Can he take out that castle? Malay, do not get Siege Ram. There are Maganels behind. I think it's worth to eject the Halbs to take out the Siege here. You just want to take out the castle.
Yeah, Maganels kill the Siege first. Nothing can kill your Rams once those Maganels are down.
He's microing the Rams underneath the castle. Now the Halbs come out. Oh, this is huge for John. He's got Trebs to back this up. And he's so confident, he's gonna drop his castle here before this one even goes down. What a big push for John the Fearless. The way John the Fearless approached this was perfect, if you ask me. And then as I said, when the pressure came in, he actually was prepped to defend it, hit a massive eco lead, and the score is 2-2 in this semifinal.
I don't know once these get upgraded to Herbalist.
Yeah,
I'm
and then the
sure.
three Maganels wouldn't do it. And I guess that's what John was thinking. He probably realized, oh shoot, I needed to engage against that earlier. He had only two Rams, and with two castles there, that would have been it. That was, I guess, another game where Evilo has dominated with aggression, right?
Yeah.
Champions destroying the castle now. We're going to a game 7 in this semifinal. There's just no way.
This semifinal has been absolutely insane, and Evilo is going to call the GG. Game number 7 on the way. It's been a long day, but goddamn, the games have been good.
Seriously. And this is the map. We're 30 seconds into game number 7. I cannot believe we're here. Okay, so both players needing defense. The spear seem there for John right now. Oh my! How? Game 7! Villager saved!
But that's so many scouts there for John the Fearless. And like you said, armor and bloodlines coming in. You can hop in the houses all you want, but
blocking
not
his
if
own
you can't
villagers.
Get to it.
He's blocking his own villagers right now. Big fights and big upgrades. And I think the upgrades might have just won John the game. What are we witnessing here? Look at these villagers, Dave.
It's going to be really tough for Evilo. It's going to be super tough, and he's YOLOing against it. I don't think he realizes armor and bloodlines is in.
And he calls it. John the Fearless does it after going down two games at the start of this best of 7. Who we think is the snake. Says GG, good luck in 10th final. Wow. And I do have it on the player scene here. I'll show you what the prize pool split is like. Look at that prize pool right now. $82,000 in Age of Empires in 2021. I'm so overwhelmed right now. Oh, the hype is real. What is God's name is happening? Ah! Oh my gosh. Holy moly. All right, well, people think it's Hera. I don't know what to say, but people are voting Viper. The people have spoken. They think that this is indeed the Viper who has won every single Hidden Cup, or that was indeed the Viper, past tense, because Evalio is out.
Most could hardly believe it. The King of AoE, the winner of Hidden Cups 1, 2, and 3, the player who had gone undefeated until the semis, the Viper, had lost to an impeccable opponent. The man behind John the Fearless was clearly that of the young Canadian pro Hera. He had reached the finals dozens of times before, but he was always one step away from the title, while the snake reigned supreme. Now, after a grueling path, first winning against Tato and then his teammate Leary, Hera knocked out his biggest nemesis, the clear favorite to win, and was merely one series away from his first solo S-tier victory in his career. However, his opponent was no small task. While his moniker was hardly a mystery, the Admiral, aka Jordan, was playing far above what anyone could have expected. Only half a year from returning to the game, Jordan's peak was clearly yet to be discovered. he had turned on the Jets, and before anyone knew, he had stormed his way to another finals and was hungry for a return to glory. For each, a victory would be a monumental moment in their career. And on the final Sunday, with over $80,000 in the prize pool, the finals of the historic Hidden Cup 4 kicked off.
So, after four straight days of nonstop Age of Empires action, two names have arrived to the grand final. We have Admiral Yi-Sun Shin, a player who has lost one game every series to get here. Don the Fearless, many people feel they have guessed, had a very tough road. Again, the Bulgarians on Arabia. I'm so impressed as we have a Krepos drop. The confidence, the Krepos drop here on the right side. It's just so well thought out.
It seems like a hard counter at this point.
Yeah,
like,
seriously. Crazy. John the Fearless has had a crazy journey. John the Fearless wins this game with some confidence, Dave. It's all about lasting on islands and using caravels and fires and demos, things like that. But Vietnamese, first time I've ever seen them picked in a Hidden Cup on island. So kind of know something weird is going to happen here. They don't have fast fire ship.
They have elite cannon galleon, but no fast fire.
Well, this is amazing strategy then as Portuguese, I think. Because if you just go into elite caravel, the enemy doesn't get fire ship. Look at that castle! He wants the wood! He can't take the wood!
He's only got the income from Fatorius right now.
And look at the scouting from Admiral. Oh my god!
The scouting is actually insane from him. He is taking out the houses now, which is good.
Is he going to take the shorefish with his bills at this point? Because that's the only thing. Yep, he's trying to take shorefish, I think.
There's shorefish and there's one tree at the back.
Oh, that's huge. Where is it?
Yeah, it's a little reed.
Oh, yeah, there you go. He should chop that tree. That's an extra. That's almost an extra galleon.
Yep. As he got a trip killed by the cannon galleon, he's going to get another one.
No!
Taken out by the cannon galleon.
Oh, God. And he called the GG. The score is 1-1, Dave. I'm with you. That one was getting progressively more and more ridiculous. Japanese in the northeast-ish for the Admiral, and then John the Fearless is playing as the Celts. I prefer Japanese if Japanese take water control and end up going into an infantry battle here, Dave.
I think three castles all within range of each other is going to be really tough, right? And then three castles on the other side. This is the great castle standoff in the middle. No one can collect the gold between them.
But it's instant three trips for John, who's going into stables? Stop making hussars, just for once, please. I think this is Hera confirmed. He's going to go paladin? Is he actually going to go paladin here? He's making knights, Dave. Did he forget what civ he is?
Kelp paladin is technically the strongest unit that they can make.
I think C Jonagers would disagree, but I get your point. And
all right, we'll go in the scenario editor. I'll get 40 paladins and you get 40 C Jonagers.
He's like, what? What is this? He'll probably start queuing something else. He didn't even have champion yet. And the trebs here are going to go down, Dave. It looks like the castle's going to go up then for John. And Paladin is in.
Paladin. And they just seem unstoppable at this moment in the game, right? What if they get into the economy?
The first time we've seen Kelp Paladin in a big tournament in... Well, I can't remember the last time.
I can't remember another time.
Yeah. What a great call here, Dave. Especially with how this game developed. It was just the perfect time for it. And now if pikemen start coming out, guess what? You go into Woad Raiders and now he's getting armor. And so it was perfect. And the game ends. John the Fearless goes up 3-1 against the Admiral.
Fantastic game sense. Imagine at the beginning of the game going into it, it's like you're Celts against Japanese. Your winning move is to make Paladin.
Well, that's actually what makes it so impressive. And we will have the final game. Or not the final game, it's live. What am I talking about? I'm that sure John the Fearless is going to win, apparently.
Admiral, he's going to start having resource problems soon, right?
Yep.
A lot of his villagers have been killed. His wood lines keep getting hit. And his eagles as well.
This could be the moment. If the castle goes up, the eagles are definitely breaking through. Even Bracer's gonna be in. How can he afford all of this?
Bracer, Ballistics, Elite Eagle. Crazy.
We have a champion. It is 4-1 for John the Fearless, Dave. What a performance, what a player. And I think when the reveal comes in and the interview comes in, we'll have a lot of questions to ask. But this isn't just a player who played heavy behind walls all the time. This isn't a player who is a complete meta player, this Hidden Cup. It was, he had Bulgarians in game one frequently. You had Mayans here, one TC play. You had out-of-the-box strategies and comeback victories when it was needed. Complete performance.
For the first time ever, Hazma El-Bahar, aka Hera, at age 21, took home $17,000 and his first S-tier 1v1 trophy. After years of near misses and grinding and growing as a person and a player, Hera was on top, and it was clear he had more to come. Hard work and preparation combined with elite skill as he dethroned the Viper. After a treacherous gauntlet, Hera was the champion of the historic Hidden Cup 4. Hello, hello. A sincere thank you to everyone that made it this far in the video. I've really enjoyed diving into these tournaments and telling their greatest storylines. So be sure to like, share, comment, subscribe, whatever. I genuinely appreciate every single one of them. I'm still fairly new to the content creation, but I promise these videos will be coming out faster and they'll be better every single time. So thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one.